Detroit bowling fans have turned out in force to support one of their own here at Thunderbowl Lanes. His name is Thomas Smallwood, and he is living a dream. Less than a year ago, he was working on an assembly line here in the Motor City. Today, he's competing for a PBA Tour title at the prestigious World Series of Bowling. But in the next chapter of the Smallwood story, a superstar opponent awaits. The two-handed wonder from down under, Jason Belmonte. We welcome you back to Detroit, the Scorpion Championship, coming your way from Thunderbowl Lanes here in Allen Park, Michigan, just outside of Detroit, as the World Series of Bowling rolls on. And here's what we have in store for you today. Jason Belmonte taking on Thomas Smallwood. Great story there in semifinal number one. The second semi has Sean Rash taking on Mike Devaney. And the PBA Women's Series presented by Bowl.com. The title match, Shannon Pluhowsky versus Liz Johnson.
Right. Through four tournaments in this year's PBA World Series of Bowling, we've seen four different men win. Today we'll make it five for five. Rob Stone, Randy Peterson back here with you in Detroit. Semifinal number one, well, you couldn't dream up a more interesting matchup of two guys who've kind of become the faces of two different things. On one hand, you have Jason Belmonte, the charismatic two-handed bowler from Australia. He is the face of the PBA right now. His opponent in semifinal number one, Tom Smallwood, who's really the face of Detroit lately. He is here essentially because last year he was laid off by General Motors.
Yeah, it's a great story because he earned a full-time exemption this season by virtue of what he did at Tour Trials in this very building. And in our opening semifinal match, he's going to take on the two-handed sensation from Australia, Jason Belmonte. And who can forget his historic win last season in Long Island? It's going to be an exciting opening match.
Yeah, and to further layer the story, Smallwood's going to have a huge fan base here, but he's also battling a nasty back injury.
Thomas Smallwood!
And the crowd is into it because that man is bowling. Thomas Smallwood, the hometown favorite from Flushing, Michigan, about 45 minutes north of Detroit, taking on Jason Belmonte. In Smallwood, laid off from the GMC Extended Cab Trucks assembly line his last day, last year, December 23rd. Tough day to leave work. It's the seven to fall late. This, Smallwood's first career TV appearance and his first season as an exempt player after having earned his exemption by finishing third this year in the PBA Tour Trials held here at Thunderbowl.
Very interesting style, Tom Smallwood. He only puts his thumb into the first knuckle. Gets a lot of hand on the ball, and what that does is it creates a very high rev rate. And speaking of high rev rates,
Jason Belmonte.
This guy.
Gets it going with two hands. The two-hand wonder from down under, Orange, New South Wales, Australia. Jason Belmonte seeking his second Lumber Liquidators Tour title. Oh, they went flying fast, didn't they?
Yeah, they sure did. Unfortunately, a pocket 4-9 split to start this match. You know, think about Jason Belmonte. We know about all that power, but with that power comes a tremendous amount of ball speed. We're talking 21, almost 21 and a half miles an hour. These numbers brought to us by the Kegel Training Center. Most professionals on the tour average about 18 or 19 miles an hour.
Whoa! That did not look good. From the moment it was released, well off target. Open frame.
Okay.
to open semifinal number one. But I like how Belmonte steps back, refocuses, gives himself a little, okay, let's start this one all over again. He won the 2009 Bowling Foundation Classic in Long Island, which earned him an exemption for this season.
Check out the grip here. No thumb, just the fingers. Bowling ball supported with both hands.
Gets them all to drop.
One bad break followed by a good one. How about Jason sporting the full carpet on his face today, huh? I love it. He's got that rough look. Takes that bowling ball that just kind of makes shrapnel out of pins.
He's got like the playoff beard going already. I like it. He makes way for Thomas Smallwood. Again, we mentioned at the outset, battling a back injury. He has a rib out of place in his left upper back. Still looking for his first strike. And this is not something that he's been dealing with in the past. They actually called a chiropractor here to the bowling center. It's a first-time problem for him, and it has given him a lot of issues.
He had to ask himself, what did I do? What did I do to deserve this?
Thomas Smallwood, an unemployed auto worker one day, and then a few months later, an exempt player here on the PBA Tour. But he didn't do it alone. His wife, Jennifer, let him chase his dream.
She's supportive. I'm lucky that she, because there's not many wives where I say, yeah, don't worry about getting a job for 4 or 5 months. Just go ahead and practice. So she understood, and she's been a good sport, and obviously now she's a great sport.
There is the Mrs. Jennifer in attendance. Time now for your Lumber Liquidators Know the Wood, and we are rolling on the Scorpion Oil pattern, Randy.
All right, well, there's been adjustments to all the patterns this season, back to 41 feet in length, but very, very tough because the patterns are playing much flatter this season because of the amount of oil that's been applied to the outside parts of the lane. Scoring environment thus far, the World Series of Bowling, very, very tough.
By the way, you may catch a glimpse from time to time of a rendering of the Scorpion oil pattern over to the left of the players. The PBA has placed it on lane 8 over there so everyone can see what the bowlers are constantly trying to figure out. Jason Belmonte working off a strike here in the third. Belmo gets them all to drop.
Wow, nice break, and that's where power and speed come into play. You think about the amount of revolutions that Jason Belmonte puts on a bowling ball. If he didn't have that high speed or that amount of speed, his bowling ball would hook into the left gutter. Check out the bent elbow, holding it with two hands. Remember, his thumb is not in the bowling ball, and he gets a big double early on in this first match.
Good shot. Good ball change. Good move.
So Belmonte with a three-bagger. More from his semifinal with Smallwood when the World Series of Bowling from Detroit returns. The PBA Scorpion Championship is brought to you by Lumber Liquidators, hardwood flooring for less. By Geico, 15 minutes could save you 15% on car insurance. By Bayer Aspirin, expect wonders. And by the United... We welcome you back to Detroit, and while we were gone, Thomas Smallwood in the fourth left a 3-10 split. He cleaned that one up. And in the fifth, left a 1-2-4-8, also able to drop them all. Belmonte in the fifth, strike in the sixth, same deal. Back to action now, Smallwood in the sixth and down by 47.
Tom Smallwood leaves a soft hand. And, Rob, you know, this form, not all that different than Jason Belmonte's. He does use his thumb, but he only puts it in halfway, and he kind of guides the ball back with both hands until the ball gets to about his hip.
Oh.
Ball. Thomas Smallwood's going to make a ball change. Let's take a look at the way these two players are playing this oil pattern. Jason Belmonte way in, the 21st board. Tom Smallwood is out around the 8th board. So about 14 to 15 boards difference. Remember, Thomas Smallwood's throwing at 3 miles an hour slower, and he's got 100 fewer RPM.
He was telling us about the great fan support he's received, not just from local people, but others that have worked at General Motors, been laid off by General Motors, retired from General Motors. Kind of has a whole GM fan crew here cheering him on, and they're hoping he can rebound here in the 7th.
Moved in where Jason Belmonte is. Maybe just not a strong enough bowling ball for that angle, as it looked like it labored a bit down the lane.
Not only is he a finalist here at the Scorpion Championship, Smallwood will be bowling for his first major, and it's the first major of the season in a few weeks. It's the PBA World Championship. There he'll face Chameleon Champion winner Bill O'Neill. On the other side of the bracket will be reigning player of the year Wes Mallott and Viper champ Rhino Page. You can see the PBA World Championship live from North Rock Lanes in Wichita Sunday, December 13th, 1 p.m. Eastern. Jason Belmonte wired up. We can talk to him throughout our match as part of PBA Inside Angle.
What kind of adjustment did you make in the fourth frame, Belmo?
I was using a pretty strong ball. I jumped in at the last couple of shots in practice, and it looked okay. 4-9, didn't throw it that bad. And then the next two, I actually thought I felt like I threw it a little softer. They hooked a little earlier, so I just ball changed to something a little weaker, and then actually stood in the same spot and tried to throw good.
Thanks, Jason.
There is Mrs. Belmonte, Kimberly. They are due again in late December, expecting a girl.
Pretty good.
Crack open that six pack for the Aussie.
.209 possible for Tom Smallwood if he strikes out. Jason Belmonte right now is in the 230s. And right now in cruise control.
What a great recovery after that open frame 8 in the first. He has been flawless since. And nobody can jinx him like me.
Wow, just when he had his foot firmly planted on Tom Smallwood's throat, just let him off the hook. You see where he's been when he was successful, right around the 21.5 board, 22.5 board. That last shot, a good 3 boards right. The result on this tough oil pattern, washout.
Here's Jason on the disadvantages of being a two-handed roller.
I think the biggest disadvantage I have is probably, you know, a set of eyes to look at my style and say, you know, Jace, you're a little off here, or because not many people know my game as well as I do, but they aren't very familiar with the two-handed style. So you really do have to ask a lot of guys that you've spent a lot of time with, traveled with, and who have seen you bowl, good and bad, and hopefully they have a good eye to help you out. So, you know, for me, the hardest thing is to get that advice. Physically. The best part about being a two-handed bowler, though, is I'm very open to suggestions.
Hard for him to throw it real straight. Hard for him to go right to left, although you don't do a whole lot of that on tour, although Walter Ray and Norm Duke have made a fortune doing that. But he can't grab it at the bottom either because his thumb isn't in it. Hard to pinch it off.
Not acceptable.
Also, he has to learn the ways of living out here on the road on the PBA Tour. That's an adjustment in itself.
Gets on the drop to Smallwood.
This kid's had a nice run here at the World Series of Bowling. I know he's hurting. He doesn't feel well. Not the greatest of ball reactions. Probably has a lot to do with how he's feeling physically. But he's had a nice run here.
We will see him in mid-December in Wichita, though, at the PBA World Championships. The first major of the season coming your way live from Wichita in mid-December.
We'll take a full pin on that one.
Hey, you can see what Jason's trying to do, and that's the real firm ball speed, keeping it tight. Going about fourth arrow to about 12 and back. So he's playing a pretty tight line for a guy that, with the big heavy hand and the high rev rate. Normally you'll see that type of player with a bit more of an arc to that shot.
Okay.
Four pins to shut him out.
All right, have a look.
And that'll do it.
That was a test shot, Rob.
Well, Jason, that one wraps it up. You move on to the championship match. Strikes 2-7. What was working for you?
The ball. It let me miss left. The other ball, I couldn't miss too far left. This one let me miss left. Clearly, when I miss right, it has no chance. So I'm going to have a long think about this in between the break and just see what's going to be the best reaction. I think the further I move left for this ball, the more trouble I'm going to get into. So,
all right, Jason, thanks for your time. Good luck in the championship match. So Belmo moves on when we return to Detroit. Semifinal number 2, Sean Rash taking on Mike Devaney. And continuing coverage of the World Series of Bowling, Thomas Smallwood with a back injury. Really no match for Jason Belmonte. The final score there, 222 to 175. Semifinal number 2, Sean Rash taking on Mike Devaney. Rash made last week's show, flamed out on the chameleon oil pattern in the semis when he lost to Ronnie Russell, 172 to 170. More on that match coming up. And it'll be Rash from Wichita, Kansas, getting us started here in our second semifinal. Great start for Rash.
Only 2 minutes this time.
May have been a little too loose last week. Bowling chameleon.
I don't know if it was so much that as it was the oil pattern was so brutal that there was so much processing being done on just trying to get your ball to strike that he just blacked out when he shot the spare. It was a huge mistake whipping all four pins when he left the 3-6-9-10, eventually only losing by 2 pins.
And that was in the 10th frame as well. Here's his opponent, Mike Devaney from San Diego. Heavy. And he is throwing urethane today.
Yeah, and we've seen it a lot here at the World Series of Bowling. The synthetic lanes in the arena are an older synthetic, there has been a lot of friction. We saw Ryan Simonelli, Rhino Page throwing urethane. Oh, bad move there. So when you get high rev guys on a high friction surface, they're going to do whatever they have to get the ball to the puck, and a lot of them have found a home with the urethane equipment.
Devaney did not make a show last season. In fact, his best finish was 7th. He did that twice at the Chameleon Championship in Taylor, not too far from here, and at the Lumber Liquidator Shark Championship in Baltimore. Devaney opening up with an open frame 8. The 7 was surrounded, but did not put up the white flag and drop.
You know, and I like this play with the urethane ball because for a guy like Mike Devaney, who really hooks it a lot, he is going to minimize that overreaction. You know, if he touches the holes a little bit more than one shot or from one shot to the next, he's not going to see the ball going sideways. And quite honestly, if he converts the 3-6-10, he's got 19 in the first frame. Well, Sean Rash can get through or get by with this amount of friction because of his ball speed. He can really bring the heater. And so he can cut down on that angular reaction by just throwing it harder.
Oh, God, hit a tree.
Well, you may be sitting at home asking yourself, where is the Scorpion King, Wes Mallott? Where is the Big Nasty?
I was bowling Sean Rash for the TV show, and coming over to this arena bay has definitely been difficult. They hook so much more, and you just run out of room. You know, he could just keep his angles closed down, and obviously he can throw it harder and still get it to hit, and he just overpowered me is what it came down to.
There's some of that power that Wes was talking about. We missed the Big Nasty, but don't worry, we'll see plenty of him in the coming weeks. He's a semifinalist next Sunday's Shark Championship, as well as the December 13th PBA World Championship, the first major of the season. Much better for Rash.
Hey, Sean, how do you like your ball reaction early on?
Besides hitting it into the water on the second frame, first two out of three shots have been pretty good. So just take one shot at a time and stay focused here.
Thanks, Sean.
Rash with an early dozen lead over Devaney. This week, Devaney in best of seven play never went more than six games. He's had pretty good luck here, at least in a couple tournaments at the World Series of Bowling. Was ninth in the Motor City Classic, 46th at the Cheetah, 41st in the Viper, then picked it up with 10th in the Chameleon. And here he is in the second semifinal at the Scorpion Championship.
Yeah, and leaving a solid nine with a urethane ball is not so lucky.
Trouble. Oh, got it.
Just one tour title for Devaney. We'll have to go back to January 5th of 03, the Geico Earl Anthony Classic out in Tacoma. He won that on the shark pattern, beating Norm Duke for his only title. Since then, 128 events without a winner's check.
Very talented guy, but also extremely funny. He is one of the funniest guys you'll ever meet.
And his first strike. So after some early match issues, Devaney may have figured things out, but it's Sean Rash with the early lead here in semifinal number two, the winner to take on Jason Belmonte for the title. Welcome back to Detroit. While we were gone, Sean Rash in the fourth gets the ball to drop in the fifth. Messenger just missing the 10. Would clean it up, though. Devaney in the fifth. He would leave the head pin and the nine pin on the spare attempt. Changes balls, going from urethane to resin, and Devaney in the sixth pays off with a strike. Back to action now. Rash up in the sixth and up 36 pins. Well, Devaney made the ball adjustment, got himself a strike, but it doesn't matter as long as Rash keeps dropping the rack.
Sean Rash is lined up. Now all he has to do is make good shots and repeat. There it is, 25th board. A lot of power, a lot of wrist cup. That yo-yo effect with the wrist at the bottom of the swing, creating all those revolutions. 460 RPMs, that's a lot.
Hey.
Good shot.
Remember, the 7-10 split has only been made three times in the history of television, but I've been told there's an opportunity to make it here.
guys were saying, hey, man, somebody leaves a 7-10 split on television here. We've been bouncing pins out all week long.
Look at the kick on that one.
Shot.
And I like how Rash is not getting down on himself about that with a big lead. Devaney, just when you think he's got things figured out between the lane and the ball,
3-6-10.
He drops a 3-6-10 on you.
Wash out. 3-6-10.
He had a 3-6-10 on this lane in the first as well.
Solid, solid, followed up with a solid 9 on that lane, then followed that up with a washout and back with a 3-6-10. So that's telling me he has absolutely no idea what to do on the right lane.
You're going to see what makes Mike Devaney such a great player. It's versatility. We talk about it all the time. Mike Devaney's throwing urethane on the right lane. Then he changed to reactive resin on the left. There's the line he's playing with urethane. Pretty straight up the second arrow. Check out the line he's playing with reactive resin. Some 20 boards left. The blue line represents what we used to do in the 80s. The red line is how we bowl today.
And that will help his cause.
Yeah, now he'll make an adjustment on the right lane. He's looks like he's got the left lane, and that gives him a chance. He can strike out for 203. Sean Rash is in the high 190s, so there is still a chance.
And Rash coming in off an open frame. Had the 7-10 last frame. Punished the 10, left the 7. Looking for his fifth strike of this match.
Look out. Mm. And it was wide as soon as it left his hand.
It had a different sound to it as well. Nothing was working right on that one.
That ball actually started inside of target, but was so angular through the front, it got way wide and had no chance of getting back. This is all of a sudden becoming a very interesting match.
1-2-10. Just the 2.
And again, remember what happened last week when Sean Rash got up in the 10th frame, let the 3-6-9-10 and whiffed all four pins. That ended him. They ended up costing him the match.
Well, the 7th and 8th frames of this match may be the one that costs him this one. We begin the foundation frame. Rash up 12, but back-to-back open frames.
Are you kidding me?
What has happened?
Just when it looked like he was lined up.
Good shot.
Just when it looked like he was lined up and was running away with this, all of a sudden disaster in the last few frames.
I don't really make that.
Devaney, 3 strikes in his last 5 frames.
Well, this is the adjustments that Mike Devaney has been trying on the right lane, none of which have been successful. His last shot, he moved in with reactive resin. It cuts through the nose. This is a big shot for him. Let's see what kind of adjustment he makes off of the last shot on this right lane.
Still strikeless on that right lane. Does anybody want this?
And it's amazing that we have an even match right now. 3 opens in a row by Sean Rash. Mike Devaney still can't hit the right lane. But he can spare this strikeout in the 10th frame and not lose.
Up a little.
There's your spare.
Wow. Not only is it interesting on the first ball. All right, 3 strikes in the 10th frame. Mike Devaney has 183. 3 strikes in the 10th frame for Sean Rash. He has 183. We'll have to go to a roll-off. I know how much you like roll-offs, Rob.
Almost as much as ham bones. Beginning in the fourth frame, Devaney's been strike, spare. Rash can just sit and watch. A big strike there for Devaney to open up the 10th.
And here's the thing, because Mike Devaney was the number 12 seed, Sean Rash the number 17 seed. If they do go to sudden death, Mike Devaney will have choice of starting lane and order. That could prove to be huge.
Fifth straight strike on that left lane.
What a comeback for Mike Devaney in this match. It started with a pocket 7-10 by Sean Rash in the seventh frame, and then two more opens to follow that.
Devaney was a disaster through three. Open frame, spare. Got a strike to clean it up in the fourth, and then another open frame in the fifth. He's figured it out since then, but Rash has collapsed as well.
Stay there.
No! That may be huge.
Come on, buddy. Come on.
182. That close to a 183.
Sean Rash needs all three in the 10th to win by one.
This is good stuff, folks. He has four strikes this match. Two on the right, two on the left. We are on the right lane right now. Done. Devaney moves on.
Boy, you could just see it in Sean's face how disappointed he is when he had the match well in hand. And all of a sudden, a great shot leaving him a pocket 7-10 completely turned around this match.
It has been a rough pair of weeks for Sean Rash. Yes, he makes the shows, but he bows out in the semis both weeks and both times in really disappointing fashion. So our men's final is set, and when we return, we go underneath Thunderbowl Lanes. Seriously, we're going to go underneath it. The PBA Scorpion Championship is brought to you by Hammer. Hammer Bowling, nothing hits like a hammer. By Vice, Vice Inserts, the choice of champions. It doesn't get any better. By Motive, high-performance bowling equipment with a fresh perspective. Get motivated. And by Barbasol. Enjoy the rush, America. New Barbasol Pacific Rush Shaving Cream. Glad you're back with us from Allen Park, Michigan, just outside of Detroit. And all the matches here at the World Series of Bowling rolled at historic Thunderbowl Lanes. Interesting history to this place.
The original Thunderbowl Arena was opened here in Detroit October 13th of 1961, and it was built to host the Detroit Thunderbirds, a team in the brand new National Bowling League.
But to get to that history, you actually have to go through this door and down. And here we are, standing on what was the original lanes. But you notice this, cinder blocks, wood, and this are the lanes the bowlers are bowling on here in Detroit.
Good Lord, we're under attack! Take cover!
Just doing warm-ups upstairs.
How close are we to the action? The ball returned right here. The ball's rolling right by your head. It's like a bowler's eBay dream down here. You got some old electrical equipment, some of the old chairs, and even, hey, why not? Disco ball. And that's the pin setter vibrating and shaking right above us. I love history and all, but I've had enough cobwebs, Thunderbowl. This is the Phantom of the Bowling Alley, signing off.
When we return, the women's match, Liz Johnson versus Shannon Pluhowsky for the title, and coming up later after that, the men's championship, Jason Belmonte versus Mike Devaney. Stone, Randy Peterson back here with you in Allen Park, Michigan, just south of Detroit. We are at Thunderbowl Lanes, our continuing coverage. with the World Series of Bowling, and now it's the PBA Women's Series presented by Bowl.com. The Scorpion Championship, Liz Johnson taking on Shannon Pluhowsky. This is Liz Johnson's second show. She made the Viper Finals as well, defeating Linda Barnes 211-196.
Mom.
Head down and starts with a strike.
And Rob, Liz Johnson, she owned this oil pattern this week. She averaged only 209 in qualifying, but in match play averaged 240.
Pluhowsky leads the seven. Pluhowsky looking for back-to-back titles. Last week, she took the PBA Chameleon Championship. She defeated Carolyn Doran Ballard 268-204. She dropped nine strikes in that win. Pluhowsky the lefty, Johnson the righty, as we take a look at the tail of the tape between these two. And here's what they did this week on the Scorpion oil pattern. Nice average for Liz.
20 pins a game difference there. But Shannon Pluhowsky has had a great run here at the World Series of Bowling, this being her third telecast.
Spare strike as she takes a seat. And I want to remind you, coming up here after the Women's Championship, the men's title match, Jason Belmonte versus Mike Devaney.
Seen that before.
Well, she's seen a lot of things in her career.
Liz Johnson playing her A game. Down and in, firm. With some good speed, nice roll. Unfortunately, a solid seven stands up.
Her favorite show, and you know I often do not go this route to talk about people's favorite shows. But for Liz Johnson, it's Three's Company.
No.
I'll see you at the Regal Beagle a little later. I think I just got myself in an extra good mood talking Three's Company. One of the best bowlers in women's history. Didn't like it, but doesn't get punished too badly for it.
This one just left of target. And you're right. Crosses over, stays out of trouble, just leaving the 6-10.
Two.
Pluhowsky. Bottom of the third, up two.
Carry.
Back-to-back jacks for Shannon P.
A lot of confidence in that young lady's head right about now as she's experienced a great run here. And look at that balance and follow through. And perfect result.
It's that kind of form that's earned her the right to be a member of Team USA for nine consecutive years now.
Hmm.
Messenger not strong enough. Take your protein in the morning.
Beat some pretty strong opponents there. Shannon O'Keefe 4-1, Kelly Kulick 4-2.
Oh no.
Put on the skinny jeans to knock down that seven. Pluhowsky looking for back-to-back titles, and she has an 11-pin lead through 3.5. PBA Women's Series presented by Bowl.com continues here. The Scorpion Final. Liz Johnson in the fourth, left at 10. Cleaned that one up. In the fifth, ditto. She was also able to get the spare. Pluhowsky with a strike in the fifth. And another in the sixth. So Johnson up in the sixth, trailing by 23, and with a new ball.
Oh, jeez.
310, the baby split. Liz Johnson just makes a ball change. And doesn't pan out, leaving the 310.
Oh for four this week on her split conversions. Take that! What a good time to get your first.
She's in trouble though, Rob, trailing by 25, one strike through six frames, now making a ball change in the middle of a game, and her opponent is lined up.
To say the least. Talk me through Liz Johnson's approach right here. Look what she does with her left hand. It kind of supports the underside of her right wrist. Right there. Just habit?
It's just her way.
Oof. And you learn, man, through being out here on the tour, everybody has their own little idiosyncrasies. That word, you know what I'm talking about.
Idiosyncrasies, yeah.
Too.
Well, and by that setup, what she's doing, to me, it looks like there's most of the weight of the bowling ball in her right hand. You look at a Norm Duke, he puts more of the weight in his left hand to start the approach. It's her way. It's what works for her.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, right now,
it's not working
nothing working for Liz Johnson.
Down 41, Pluhowsky dialed in. Four of the last five frames for Shannon have been strikes. Liz Johnson hasn't struck since the opening frame. Pluhowsky in control to win her second straight title on the women's series.
Oh, no. Looking to stay clean with a spare.
Stays clean with the spare conversion. Pluhowsky lost in the season opening women's championships to Kelly Kulik, now set to make it two straight titles here in Detroit. Come on, Messenger! Muscle up!
Okay, turned into almost a trip three. Just a little bit wide. Again, the nice break of only the three pin standing. She's in complete control. A spare here, only two more frames to seal the deal. Have her capture her second consecutive win in as many weeks.
Now Johnson can max out at only a 208. The lead at 39 for Pluhowsky as Johnson does step up.
When you can see it, just no down lane reaction for Liz Johnson. And the ball looks like it's just skating on ice all the way to the pins.
Next Sunday, 1 Eastern here on ESPN, it's the PBA Shark Championship. Wes Mellott versus Jack Jurek. Michael Fagan versus Jason Couch. On the ladies' side, Kelly Kulik versus Carolyn Doran Ballard.
Now you see that ball, how it rolled up and faced the pocket perfectly. She hasn't had that look or that reaction the entire match. And that's what's so tough about a one-game match. You have practice, you make your decision, and then the lights come on, and all of a sudden it doesn't work. Can get pretty uncomfortable real quick.
Pluhowsky, who calls her game after Parker Bone III, with maybe her first poor toss of the afternoon, but a makeable spare now.
Swing drifts high, leaving the 247. Again, the best Liz Johnson can shoot, 198. Shannon with a spare is still in the two teens. Uh-oh.
Ooh.
Now it's going to get a little more interesting with that shot there, because Shannon right now, strike, spare, spare, strike, she will shoot 202. If she opens again, Liz Johnson can strike out and steal this title. Now we have a situation, Rob.
Well, and Liz Johnson is just the woman to step up and take advantage of it.
After completely dominating this entire match, if Shannon doesn't convert here, she is in jeopardy of losing this title.
And Liz Johnson will walk up in the 10th, having struck in the 9th, and she may have found herself some newfound confidence. Not a bad effort.
Wow, so it looked like it was coming out of the back pin. Liz Johnson now with two strikes in the 10th frame and five. She will steal this title. Going to the ball she just went to on the left lane that was high flush.
Pluhowsky done with a 192. No such luck.
Won't happen. Left of target the whole way. She knew it as soon as she let go of it.
So it's back-to-back titles for Pluhowsky. The top three finishers in this event, Pluhowsky, Liz Johnson, and Kelly Hulick, they've all qualified for the PBA Women's Series Showdown presented by Bull.com by virtue of having already won an event this season. So the qualifier for this event will be fourth-place finisher Michelle Feldman. The PBA Women's Series Showdown presented by Bull.com will be televised by ESPN next year, Sunday, April 18th. 192 to 177. Pluhowsky takes another title and a $10,000 winner's paycheck to boot. So coming up next, it's our men's title match, the two-handed wonder, Jason Belmonte versus Mike Devaney. Welcome you back to Thunderbowl Lanes, ESPN's continuing coverage of the World Series of Bowling. It is time now for the Scorpion Championship on the men's side. And it should be a good one. Jason Belmonte in search of his second career Lumber Liquidators Tour title, taking on Mike Devaney, also seeking his second tour title. Devaney took down Sean Rash, 182-162 in his semifinal match. The 36-year-old native of San Diego has not won a tour title since January 5th of 03.
Great start. Now let's take a look at the left-right lane comparison. See the strike percentage on the left lane, 56%. Not great.
Wow.
But look at the percentage on the right lane. Now, here's where strategy comes in. Jason Belmonte was the number 6 qualifier. Mike Devaney, the number 12 seed. That means Jason Belmonte has choice of starting lane. He chose to have Mike Devaney start the match, which forces Devaney to finish on the right lane.
And here is Jason on that right lane. Shrapnel all over the place, but only 9 dropped.
Jason Belmonte has made a big move to the right since his first match. Remember, he was around the fourth arrow, now around first arrow. Remember, Mike Devaney, he's still way in at 6-0. That's a lot of real estate between those two lines to the pocket. You know, and that's what happens on a tough oil pattern. You got guys playing all over the place.
Belmonte, the two-handed bowler from Australia.
Last season's Rookie of the Year. I'm not sure there's a continent he hasn't bowled on. A true world superstar going up against a very unassuming Mike Devaney, each with one career title.
Now, Belmonte had to wait essentially till just about the end of last season to get his first title and earn his exempt status for this season. Like to get it done a little bit earlier this year. Whew. That curled in late, but did it in time.
Playing out on both lanes.
I mean, way out.
Fourth board, a lot of speed and a lot of revs. Now let's see what Mike Devaney does on this right lane. Remember in the last match, he never struck on this lane in five shots.
A little.
I tell you, the messengers need to hit the weight room here.
and on this oil pattern, in this surface, the middle part of the lane hooks so much more than it did last season. So what it does is it forces the players that want to play in farther left, and then they have to create more angle to the right. The problem is there's not enough friction right to get the ball back. As soon as they square up an inch, the ball goes through the nose. That's why the scores are so low.
Take a bioblast look at Mike Devaney. He's bowled for a living since the age of 18, is big into thoroughbred racing, and owns some minority interest in several horses. Heavy. And that's what he thinks of it.
That's the thing that you see with the big hook balls. When they do miss, it's usually a pretty nasty design facing you. The big four only being made one time on television ever, and that was by Walter Ray Williams Jr.
Walter Ray with one title already this season, having won the Motor City Open.
Hit the. Be soft with it. Jace.
What he's saying is right here at the bottom of the swing, he just gets too much ball, and that causes that bowling ball to go sideways once it comes off the end of the pattern. Lucky to only leave the 3-6-10.
Uh-oh.
To the left of number three, but enough to drop them all.
Oh, I hate that stare.
Well, at least he's honest, and he stays up 16 and stays clean. Spare, I should say, for Belmonte. It's his first year full-time on the tour.
No.
Okay.
There we go with the
ball. Ball just never grabbing the lane, so you could see just how speed sensitive it is, just how brutal the soil pattern is.
2-7-10.
Close.
Great pickup.
Ooh, baby.
big spare.
Jason, you left yourself two difficult spare conversions the last two frames. What does that do as you get ready for the fifth?
Mate, I'm telling you, the 3-6-10 was harder to spare for me than that last one. big momentum swing for me, I feel. Could have had two opens quite easily, so to have them both clean, I'm very happy with myself. I had a go at that last one. Got nothing to lose, so it's a long way home with a second place, so I want to come here with a win.
Thanks, Jason. We appreciate your time.
Cheers, boys.
Jason will head home to Australia after this, but we head to the break with a 13-pin lead for Jason Belmonte here at the PBA Scorpion Championship. The PBA Scorpion Championship is brought to you by Lumber Liquidators, hardwood flooring for less. By Geico, 15 minutes could save you 15% on car insurance. By Bayer Aspirin, expect wonders. And by the United States Bowling Congress, the all-new bowl.com, your online source for all things bowling. Log on to bowl.com today. Rob Stone, Randy Peterson back here with you for the men's finals of the Scorpion Championship. Mike Devaney down 13 as he begins his effort in the fourth.
From that inside angle, pretty much anywhere on the lane, you have to be just about perfect. It's got to be perfect through the front part of the lane with the right amount of speed in hand.
Well, good news for Devaney. That's his first strike of the day on that right lane. And again, Randy, as you mentioned it, he is going to close out this title match on that right lane.
Yeah! Two in a row. This guy's like a cat, man. He's got nine lives.
El Gato.
I love it. Maybe that's his new nickname. Sean Rash had him buried. He comes back and wins that match. He's trailing early on in this match by a bunch. He comes back, throws a double. Now he's only down by three.
I'm not sure, though, if you drop Devaney from the roof of this bowling center, he'll land on his feet, though.
I'm going to leave that one alone.
Here's Belmonte in the fifth, his lead reduced to just three. Jason Belmonte wants to be known as more than just that guy who happens to throw it two-handed.
For my entire life, people have always noticed the style first, and it's something I've dealt with. And, you know, I accept it. It's no problem. That's just what people see, and it's probably the first thing that pops into their head is that guy's crazy. But, you know, hopefully by the end of my career when I hang the shoes up, they'll say he was a two-handed bowler, but he was a pretty good bowler too.
It was a slow start to Jason Belmonte here at the World Series of Bowling, but here he is in the title match.
Take a look at some of the moves he's been making the last couple of games here in this first match, right around the fourth arrow, and here in the title match up first arrow. One of the keys to being a great professional bowler is being versatile, being able to play all the angles and have all the tricks. Jason just happens to do it with two hands.
Still just one strike for Jason here in the finals. Make it two. Now, we talked last season about all the external and internal pressure that has been put on him, the PBA really kind of putting him out there to be the face of this league, and he took it to heart, and he burdened a lot of things. And one of the great quotes that stuck out was, you know, I was worrying more about my voicemails than my bowling. I got to get back to this report. I got to do this. And he finally said right before that Long Island Classic that he won, he said, voicemails are going to wait. I'm going to bowl. He had problems again with the same thing starting at the World Series of Bowling, getting interviews here in Detroit. He's pushed it back, and now his game is back.
Yeah, and this couldn't have happened at a worse time for Mike Devaney. This is like getting punched repeatedly in the gut. On a double, pocket 7-10.
And on that right frame that he had a little confidence finally on. Goes after the 7.
Remember the last match, pocket 7-10 started Sean Rash's demise. Let's see how Mike Devaney rebounds from his pocket 7-10.
Devaney, open frame, strike, strike, open frame. Down 16, we kick off the seventh.
Took a lot. Holy moly.
Jeez.
Again, having to be so precise on an extremely tough oil pattern, Mike Devaney looking to convert the two pin. And a lead, or excuse me, a deficit that once was only three is now back to 16.
Mike. Jeez.
The chance to design your own bowling ball or pin is now available at PBA.com. You can upload photos or logos to personalize your ball or pin for the perfect gift or award. Simply head to PBA.com, click on the Shop tab, and choose Customize Bowling Products. That is a great idea. Might have to get you one of me for your birthday.
Come on, come on. Oh. Good shot, mate. Good shot.
It was. It was a really good shot under these circumstances. And you see that ball again, just slightly inside first arrow. Four pin, easy single pin spare. Convert, maintain your 16-pin lead, stay out of trouble. He is clean through six. Now make it seven. Frames, that is.
Good job.
Now he's learning more and more, not only just about bowling, but bowling in the United States and bowling on the PBA Tour. You know, I had a great quote earlier saying, I got off to a really bad start here at the World Series of Bowling, but I've come to realize it is a long road out here. I tend to be short-sighted, but you have to get past that and just bowl. He's not a goal setter. You know, I asked him this. He's like, you know, I don't want to do that, Rob. I know this is cliche. I am frame by frame. I want that approach all season so I don't get ahead of myself.
Wow.
Now that the same leave that he picked up in the third frame.
This shot here is about a board and a half left of the last shot he threw in the sixth frame on that lane. And it looked like his angle was just a little bit straighter up that lane. So again, this flat oil pattern, his rev rate, there's absolutely no chance for that ball to hold its line.
And again, this is something you and I have seen the last couple weeks. No one really kind of taking a game by the scruff of its neck and saying, this is mine.
There's one.
Yes, man, he left one, leaving the 10 pin.
Find a way to spare it.
Lead at two.
Well, he said it. He hated that spare. He hated the 3-6-10. Comes back and chops it. In the eighth, Devaney now only down by two.
And working on a spare.
Hook a lot. Hook a lot. There we go.
Second strike on that right lane.
More life for El Gato? You think he'd appreciate you nicknaming him El Gato? What a great touch on this shot, though, huh?
Now that was a huge strike. If he can follow it up in the ninth, momentum clearly in the Devaney camp. Again, Devaney will close on that right lane. It was a big issue in the semis, not so much in the final. Two strikes, but he did have an open frame on it in the sixth.
Hold it, hold it.
Yeah!
Boom!
Yeah! What a shot. But remember, he's got to finish on the tough right lane. Mike Devaney can strike out for 210. The best Jason Belmonte can shoot now, 202. I guarantee you one thing. Somebody today will be winning for the second time in their career.
Bold call, Randy. Bold call. Belmo in the ninth, looking for just his third strike.
Just like that.
And finding it. Oh, that was textbook. Put that on a DVD and show it to future two-hand bowlers.
I get to be right now, 'cause I can't
That ball there right at about 22 miles an hour. I mean, that's bringing the steam.
Bad intentions. We go to the 10th. Great finish lined up for you. Belmonte down 8 on the left lane. Two of his 3 strikes have come on that left lane here in the championship match.
Oh, trouble.
Rut row.
Oh! Not only is he down by 8, but now he has to shoot not only the 3, 6, 10, but you got to throw the 9 in there as well.
Just for good measure. How did he avoid that one?
Mike Devaney needs 7. He's going to win for the second time, and talk about a guy that just wouldn't go away. What an amazing comeback, if you will. The match before against Sean Rash, now against Jason Belmonte.
Jason is stewing. Devaney about to win. And there you go.
Nice effort.
He is going to win for the second time and the first time in almost 6 years.
Puts an end to a nasty slide, and Belmonte is going to have to get on a plane and go home to Australia chewing on that loss. Big win, though, for Mike Devaney. Was left for dead in the semis and essentially in the final, and El Gato stayed alive. The Scorpion Championship goes to Mike Devaney, 189-170. Let's see how he did it with the Geico Championship recap.
Mike Devaney rebounds strong after a 7-10 split in the 6th. He comes back with a strike in the 8th and 9th to double up.
Yeah, baby, yeah.
Now it's Jason Belmonte's turn. A strike in the 10th frame is his only chance to win. Oh, instead, it's a 3-6, 9-10 spare. Mike Devaney wins his second career title.
So Devaney is the 4th PBA versatility swing qualifier for upcoming PBA Experience Showdown presented by Bowl.com. You can see it Sunday, April 11th, 1 to 3 p.m. Eastern on ESPN. In addition to the 5 PBA players who qualify for this event, the 6th and final qualifier will be an amateur selected from a PBA Experience League. Here's Randy with our winner.
Mike Devaney, gee, I don't know where to start. Rob Stone has given you a new nickname, El Gato. It seemed like he had 9 lives today. Can you describe the seesaw emotions that went through your mind?
I was just trying to get 9. and 8 sometimes. The lanes are really difficult today, and, you know, it was a little luck and a lot of hard work, and, you know, just made a couple of key shots when it counted. You know, it put the pressure on Sean, and he missed, and then Belmo kind of melted down there at the end when the pressure got to him. So, but he'll be back. He's too good not to be back. But I was the one to get come through today. I got lucky.
That right lane looked awful. How were you somehow able to start figuring out a way to strike on it?
I flattened my hand out a little bit and just tried to kind of leave the half 10 shot, and then I left a 7-10. So, other than that, this pair of lanes is brutal. It's just brutal. They're tough. You know, it's good. 190 is a really good game.
Congratulations, Mike.
Next Sunday, 1 Eastern here on ESPN, it's the PBA Shark Championship. For Randy Peterson and